Vienna, for centuries the capital city of the Austro-Hungarian monarchy and the residence of the royal house of Habsburg. It draws between 5 and 6 million tourists every year. There are many reasons to visit Vienna. One of these is situated less than 15 minutes walk from the main attractions of this beautiful city on the banks of the Danube, Schönbrunn Castle, a UNESCO World Heritage Site. The green oasis of this truly imperial baroque complex covers an area of 17 hectares. More than 8,000 animals from more than 700 species live here, in the oldest, and according to the Viennese, the most beautiful zoo in the world. It is a refuge steeped in centuries of history. The construction of the zoo was ordered by the Emperor Franz I, Franz Stefan of Lorraine, who was married to the Empress Maria Theresa. He visited the zoo personally for the first time on the 31st of July 1752, together with friends from the nobility. This day has been considered the anniversary of Schönbrunn Zoo ever since, which means the zoo is over 260 years old, and therefore the oldest zoo in the world. But despite such an aristocratic historical background, the former imperial menagerie is now absolutely a zoo fit for the 21st century.
I believe that the combination of baroque ambience and modern zookeeping makes Schönbrunn Zoo unique. The zoo is not big, a total of 17 hectares, of which a large part is taken up by the historical baroque complex. The emperor's breakfast pavilion in the centre, surrounded by the 12 lodges. That is what they were called at the time. The 13th, which you can see behind me, was always intended for people rather than animals. And that is where we have our offices today.
But that certainly doesn't mean that the administration of the zoo hasn't expanded since the 18th century. Far from it. And it's not just animal lovers who get their money's worth here, but connoisseurs of architecture too. The more than 2 million people who visit the zoo annually are told all about the Emperor's Pavilion, the historical centre of the complex. The construction of the Breakfast Pavilion was commissioned by Franz I in 1759. Then, as now, it was generally believed that a good breakfast set you up for the day ahead, and they certainly had a majestic starting point here in the pavilion. In 2012, Josef Ignaz Mildorfer's beautiful ceiling fresco, dating back to the time of Maria Theresa, was restored. Here, culinary and visual delights go hand in hand, and they've been serving not only breakfast, but also the classic Wiener Schnitzel and goulash for lunch, and of course, coffee and cake in the afternoons, for a long time now. The stylish interior retains the atmosphere of the pavilion's earliest days, despite the many setbacks that were to follow.
With such a long history, of course, there have been a few ups and downs. At the end of the 19th century and the beginning of the 20th century, the zoo was one of the best in Europe, with a huge number of animals. Over 3,500 animals from 700 different species. Then the First World War began and a major economic slump set in. And after the Second World War, the zoo was on the brink of being closed after extensive bombing in February 1945. But thankfully, those responsible were able to build the zoo up again. By the end of the 80s, the zookeeping methods had become somewhat outdated, and several well-known personalities, both political and professional, were of the opinion that the zoo ought to be shut down, and that the only alternative was to turn the complex into a museum. Luckily, it didn't go that far, and the zoo was privatized in 1992, when it became a GSMBH, or company with limited liability. That was 20 years ago, which means we're also celebrating the founding of the Tiergarten Schönbrunn GSMBH today. That was the beginning of a significant upturn for the zoo. And now things are going really well again.
And the charm of the complex as it is today lies in the harmonious combination of cultural heritage, imperial panache and modern facilities. The giraffe house was constructed in 1828 in place of an earlier baroque building and is virtually unchanged outwardly to this day. From here, these tall, graceful animals that can reach a height of 6 meters keep an eye on things from their own very special perspective. And fresh food is always available. Keepers know exactly what they want. Suspended feeding basket right up there is absolutely perfect for them. This species has been in charge here for more than 240 years. The first elephant came to Schönbrunn in 1770. 8 years after that, the zoo was open to the entire population of Vienna, and the nobility no longer had sole rights to the pleasures of watching these majestic creatures. Entry was free of charge for decently dressed people, in the words of the time. As now, the main focus of the visitors' interest was in the animals' offspring. Children and animals always steal the show. And the children of animals are the absolute masters. Giant pandas at Schönbrunn are truly sensational. Only very few zoos in the world possess a breeding pair. The species is highly endangered, and there are only around 1,600 pandas living in the wild today. The People's Republic of China sent the panda couple Yang Yang and Long Hui from the Zun Wulong breeding station to Vienna in 2003 as part of an act of diplomacy. Because these distinctive black and white bears are very hard to please and don't breed readily in captivity, the birth of the first homegrown panda cub in Vienna in 2007 was a zoological sensation. Fu Long, the happy dragon, was celebrated like a pop star by visitors and local and foreign press alike. In 2009, Fu Long was relocated to his ancestral homeland of China. Fu Long's parents at Schönbrunn didn't sit around waiting for an invitation either. His brother, Fu Hu, the happy tiger, has been looking out at the world with his round eyes since August 2010. and fresh bamboo always tastes good. In addition to its own breeding program, the zoo also supports efforts to protect pandas in their natural habitat in China. In contributing to the survival of the species, Schönbrunn is building bridges to the rest of the world. While here at home in Vienna, people generally make it their business to be open to new things whilst preserving the old.
Yes, building new facilities at Schönbrunn and renovating old ones is always a big challenge because those responsible for the protection of historical buildings carry a great deal of authority. The entire zoo, especially the historic Baroque section, is a protected monument, and we do always work very hard to retain the Baroque character. But I think we've done a good job in that respect in the last few years. And we've also succeeded in combining this with modern zookeeping and up-to-date facilities. A good example is our big cat compound, where visitors to the zoo pass by the old enclosures before reaching the open enclosures, from where they have a great view of the cheetahs.
In the mid-90s, the existing enclosures for the zoo's big cats were integrated into the architecture of a brand new big cat enclosure. Behind this is a generously proportioned open area covered with netting for the tigers and the jaguars. The big cats exert a fascination all of their own. And when you stand here for a moment, you sense the beating heart of the wild. His ancestors arrived at the zoo at the beginning of the 19th century, but now the lions too have access to an impressive open area. While inside their accommodation, they enjoy the modern comforts of heating and ventilation. Lion cubs have been bred at Schönbrunn for over 130 years. Hiding away in the dense foliage is one of the panthers, big cats that are actually black jaguars or leopards. Their natural habitat is in Southeast Asia. But like the tigers, they now also enjoy the comforts of Vienna. And the visitors don't seem to disturb the peace. You can tell when they're content, just like a domestic cat. But here, it's better to keep your distance. Tigers, the largest of the feline predators, can grow up to 2 meters in length, depending on their origins. And as they grow, so do their teeth and their paws. The South American compound is altogether more relaxed.
There are two ponds in the South American compound, both with flowing water and a filtration system. This keeps the water nice and clean, and the animals love taking a swim in the summer. The capybaras particularly enjoy swimming.
But it's not just capybaras who feel at home here, as you can see from the vicuñas. These are South American camelids who usually live at altitudes of 3,500 to 5,500 meters in Ecuador, Peru, Bolivia, Argentina, and Chile. Schönbrunn's South American compound, which is a pampas-based environment, is a bit like flat sharing, with enough space for everybody. And nobody fights about food. Even the visitors notice this.
In the South American compound, several species of animal live together in harmony. For instance, the vicuñas, the tapirs, the capybaras, and the seremas get along very well with one another. The tapirs and capybaras share a bed of hay at night, which is really cute. And not just at night. After a good breakfast, they often snuggle up together and sometimes take a communal nap. It's really great to see.
And the visitors certainly seem to agree. The capybaras, which are the largest rodents on Earth, are well used to visitors and are extremely sociable.
I'm preparing the food for the tapirs. They get a mixture of vegetables and fruit. We usually cut them into bite-sized pieces, because the tapirs don't eat alone. The vicuñas and the capybaras join them for their meals. In order to ensure each animal gets its share and no friction occurs, we distribute the food all over the enclosure, which also ensures that they have to walk around the entire enclosure until they've had their fill. So it increases the animal's quality of life.
Although tapirs usually create a rather lazy impression, the ones at Schönbrunn are extremely lively. Definitely nobody here who would fight the anteaters for their food.
In their natural habitat, anteaters eat 30,000 termites a day. Because we can't give this to them, we prepare specially balanced food, rich in vitamins, which they get early in the morning and again in the afternoon, consisting of meat, dog pellets, rolled oats, curd cheese, vitamin drops, oak bark, and peat. We put it all together in a blender and give it to them early in the morning or in the afternoon. In the morning, they just get a little snack. We also give them mealworms in rotting wood, so they have to use their claws to get them out. This prevents the claws from getting too long.
But the long tongue also comes into play here. Anteaters are not as sociable as the other South American animals. In nature, they're solitary animals that only come together to mate. The production of offspring in the zoo is a rather sensitive issue. Today, we can see clearly in here, but sometimes it gets misty or even stormy, just like in the real rainforest. Since its 250th anniversary in 2002, the zoo has boasted this very special attraction, the Rainforest House. The idea is that the visitors not only have the opportunity to admire the rich flora and the diversity of animal life in this 1,200 square meter structure, but they can also get a sense of the endangered expanse of trees, ferns, mosses and lianas, a habitat that is shrinking at an alarming rate in the wild by 200,000 square kilometers every year due to deforestation and burning. Complicated computer-controlled technology with heating in the glass ceiling, the walls, the floors and the soil ensures a minimum temperature of 25 degrees Celsius and a humidity level of 80% throughout the year. Flying foxes. If you like, you can attend their very own air show in a darkened room. Here too, the young enjoy special attention.
Well, we have a little nursery in the kitchen at the moment. These are the flying foxes that have ended up with us this year for various reasons. Often there are cases where they simply fall or the mothers can't feed them anymore and abandon them, for example. So we take them in and look after them. Sometimes when the breeding season starts, the males might harass a young female to the extent that the baby falls down. There are many reasons why they end up with us. When the babies are 2 or almost 3 months old, we no longer have to take them home with us at night, which is much more practical. Then we just have to give them the support they need and see that they have the opportunity to learn to fly properly, which is very important. They only stay with us for 3 months, just so they can grow up a bit, before we put them back in the rainforest house, where they will hopefully reintegrate into the group. Up till now, it has always worked very well.
Only flying is more interesting than this individual feeding.
They don't rely on echolocation like bats do. This is evident from their big eyes. They can see very well, unlike the bats, and they orientate themselves through their eyesight and their excellent sense of smell. They smell the fruit and fly to it. They can orientate themselves very well.
And here, everyone's ready for the night. Another nocturnal creature, and a very demanding one too, is the koala.
So, eucalyptus rum. Sehr viele Arten.
This is the eucalyptus room. And these are the branches. There are lots of different types, which are delivered fresh from Vienna and England. And this is Robusta, for example. They're lovely shoots. I'm going to give them to him now. Look, here are some fresh shoots. Delicious.
But before pleasure, there are a few routine jobs to be done.
Go koalas werden jeden Tag abgewogen.
The koalas are weighed every day at 4 p.m. This is very important in order to know how the animal is doing, whether everything is okay. So, what weight today? 4.37. That's good. I'll make a note of it. Come on, Murali. It's all okay. We're done now.
He enjoys being carried around.
We weigh them at 4 p.m. every day, so the visitors get to see a little bit of action from the koalas.
This friendly Australian could easily gain another 10 kilos. Imagine walking through 130,000 litres of water with dry feet. The aquarium tunnel connects the aquarium and terrarium houses. An amazing variety of fish swim around you as you walk through this passage. Even stingrays can be seen gliding above your head. The aquarium and terrarium houses were opened in 1959 and were extensively renovated at the turn of the millennium. Fish are always welcome here too, in this case at mealtimes. A love of fish unites the inhabitants of the Polarium. Penguins and sea lions with water temperatures of just 8 degrees, which is really comfortable for these animals. The visitors like a magnet. A seal show complete with acrobatics. Thank you. it looks like nobody's at home in the small ape house. Although this group of between 13 and 15 lemurs could certainly stage a passable ballet.
We're in the kitchen of the small ape compound. There are two enclosures here, one for the gibbons and the other for the lemurs, and I'm now preparing the food for the lemurs. Actually, it's a supplementary meal, because they have their main meal of the day in the morning. Now they're getting an activity meal, which gives them something to do so that they don't get bored. This is a very simple activity meal. I'm going to cut apples into small pieces and distribute them all over the enclosure. I'm also going to scatter a few pellets in the inner part of the cage so that they really have to search. It should keep them busy for a while.
The animals at Schönbrunn are not allowed to become inactive.
The lemurs are very friendly apes, but they're a bit, well, I don't want to call them stupid. Let's just say they're not the brightest sparks. They belong to a group of apes called wet-nosed primates, which were formerly referred to as prosimians. They're actually somewhat primitive primates that are not very highly developed.
Do know what's important in life. And they're certainly not stupid.
The interesting thing about the lemurs is that they live in a matriarchal society. That means that with lemurs, the ladies have the say. There are two separate levels of hierarchy, one among the females and the other among the males. And the female who comes at the bottom of the female pecking order still enjoys a higher status than the male at the top of the male pecking order. This comes from the fact that the females always produce their young in the dry season, when there's not much food available. So for the survival of the species, the females have the highest status and can eat first, which in turn raises the survival rate of the babies. Although, despite this advantage, the mortality rate among baby lemurs is still very high. Lemurs have many scent glands on various parts of the body. Some are in the hands, and some in the armpits. They rub their tails over these scent glands, and then, smelling of perfume, they stand before the males, waving their tails at them. It's that black spot there. It's a whole lot of glands together. There's another in the armpit, but it's not easy to see. You can still see the glands easily in young animals. But the armpit is small, so you can't see the glands unless you search under the fur. The males have a little spur by their scent glands, so that they can scratch open the bark of the trees while simultaneously exuding their scent, thereby marking their territory. The good thing about scattering the food, apart from the fact that it gives the lemurs something to do, is that the animals lower down in the pecking order also have a good chance of finding sufficient food. This is not the case with set feeding places, where the less dominant animals get the less tasty, though usually the healthier, food. This also means that the more dominant animals tend to eat the less healthy food, because they always pick out the sweetest fruit and leave what they don't want for the others. Let's see if the lemurs will come out if they realize we're throwing their food around. One is already outside, one of the less dominant animals. It's going to make the most of the opportunity, but the others are already coming out. Like other primates, lemurs can't swim, We therefore leave the access to the primate island open all year round, unless the pond freezes over. Then they have to be shut up in their house, otherwise they would escape over the ice.
Is somewhat livelier with the gibbons in the adjoining small ape compound. They're arboreal apes. As you can see from their agility, 3-meter leaps are not unusual. And they draw a huge number of visitors. This ape house is called, if you'll excuse the pun, the Orangery. The orangutans live in what was once the orangery of the emperor's 19th century palm house. Since 1920, the building has been used as a film studio several times. Still watch scenes that are fit for a film. Only the stars have changed a little bit since then. Meerkats are an African suricate species, and they're among the Viennese people's best-loved animals, especially the females. Their burrows can be as deep as 3 meters underground. But there's also a lot going on above the ground. Suricates are extremely sociable. They live in colonies of up to 30 animals in the drier parts of southern Africa. While they're feeding, they always have security personnel on duty to warn them of any impending danger, perhaps from the air, with loud warning cries. In the blink of an eye, the entire troop disappears into the burrows. Exemplary social behaviour can also be observed in this open enclosure. In the case of the pelicans, the males and females split their brooding duties 50-50. They both take turns sitting on the nest until the chicks hatch, and then they alternate the duties of searching for food and tending the chicks. And for most of the residents of this enclosure, the menu consists of fish. Thank you. Breeding pelicans in captivity is not easy. The birds are very sensitive to any disturbance. Here are some of the most photographed celebrities at Schönbrunn, the flamingos. The distinctive rose colour of their feathers comes from the not very attractive planktonic algae that they eat. The downturned beak of the flamingo has special lamellae on the edges to filter the food out from the water. As you can see, they're all working very hard at keeping their feathers a perfect rose pink. There's a new surprise in every corner. And here, where the aviaries are bordered by the historic walls, you'll find the most amazing variety of different species, all under one roof. The bald ibis is worth a particular mention, although it might not appear so at first glance. They no longer occur in the wild in Europe, and there are fewer than 2,600 specimens left throughout the world. The specimens at Schönbrunn are part of an international breeding program, which is making an effort to save the species. But if you prefer something a bit more colourful, there are other species too, such as this scarlet ibis. Exotic species in a historical setting. The allure of Schönbrunn has always been this beguiling combination. But there are also corners of the zoo that are very down to earth.
We've created a nature trail here. It begins in the Tyrolean farmyard with its old-fashioned domestic animals. Most people don't realise that they can also be endangered. Here you can see some ancient Austrian domestic species that are endangered.
The farm, which is a protected monument, was dismantled from its original location in the Tyrol and rebuilt here brick by brick. The Pustertal black and white pied cattle seem to be just as contented here as the other centuries-old domestic animals, such as the Tuck's cattle or the Montafon brown fee. And on Saturdays and Sundays, you can see how butter and cheese are made. And the news is gradually getting around that these products are a little bit superior to what you find on supermarket shelves. And then you can take a ride on the Schönbrunn, a little train that weaves its way round the entire zoo. meet some of the heavier residents of the zoo in the Rhino Park. Both the indoor and outdoor facilities offer the Asian rhinoceros the things it loves the most: open space, swampy grassland, and large expanses of mud. And there is still plenty of space left for other Asian animals, like the black buck and the chital. And these particular pachyderms feel quite at home here. This compound was part of the long-term New Projects development concept, whereby existing older compounds became part of the replanning process. Although space is limited at Schönbrunn, the zoo is growing constantly. It is a continual experiment in conservation and development, and there is no shortage of ongoing plans.
I think that in recent years we've succeeded very well in combining modern zookeeping and modern facilities here. It's very important to us to draw the visitors into our work, and we'll soon have a polar dome and an information centre for visitors adjoining the Polarium, which will cover the Arctic and Antarctic regions and look into the global warming that's having such a dramatic effect on them.
And so, everyone who visits Schönbrunn can join the journey from the past into the future.